The world is waiting. The revolution will not be televised. It's happening online. LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. You're not fooling me, 'cause I can see. Hi, I'm Bethan and I'm here on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to chat for the next hour or so about dogs and our relationship with them. And why is it so important that we have one? Are they our best friends? And before I go on, I'd like to play you some dog-related music. So I thought we'd play a bit of a Florence and the Machine and our dog days are over. Happiness.
Of the city, LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. You're not fooling me, 'cause I can see. Hi everyone, it's Bethan and you're listening to Liverpool Community Radio. I just mentioned before about dogs, and I'm going to be talking about dogs until you're dog tired. Okay, maybe not. Anyway, today I've brought my friend Pam in to talk about her dog, who's a lovely working cocker spaniel called Ruby. But before I bring her in to talk to her, I thought we'd talk a bit more about dogs really. So, first of all, I thought I'd talk about me, because hey, it's quite interesting for a bit anyway. And my first interest in dogs was because my great auntie had a dog and who was Welsh. Well, my family's Welsh, and so the dog was Welsh. And so we used to speak to Cher, that's what her name was, in Welsh, and it went really well. Anyway, my final conversion came from an ex-boyfriend who had a Saluki, which is in the member of the Greyhound family. And then once upon a time, a friend, Katie, and me were chatting about dogs. And the next thing I remember was approaching a Greyhound trust tent and signing up for a Greyhound. I had no regrets, and I had Leo, my dearly departed Greyhound, who was with me then for the next 7 years. But enough about my dog. I think we'll listen to a bit of a Black Dog by Led Zeppelin, and you can come back and listen to Liverpool Community Radio.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. The views and opinions of presenters and guests on LCR Liverpool Community Radio are not necessarily representative of Liverpool Community Radio, LCR, its directors, or their funders.
The world is waiting. The revolution will not be televised. It's happening online. LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio. And I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. Hi, you are listening to Beth on Liverpool Community Radio. And I'm talking about dogs and our relationship with them. Now, from Joe Public down to up to the Queen, we love to be surrounded by our dogs. Even the royalty has always been associated with pets, especially the corgis. In fact, we've been known to keep dogs as pets for at least 12,000 years. And we've always used dogs for hunting as well, unfortunately. Far back as 1534, hare coursing was dead popular. And it's a matter of opinion now if you're pro using dogs for hunting or not. Anyway, in fact, they've got a small claim to fame not far from here. In fact, two women decided to make use of the really great connection between man and beast by setting up guide dogs for the blind in the Wallasey area in 1931. And I have to say, sometimes we're not always positive about the way we treat our dogs. And Battersea Dogs and Cats Home was originally opened in 1860 to look after its first strays. And it survived two world wars, the Great Depression and a funding crisis. So, what I thought I'd do now is, I'd bring my friend Pam in. And I'd like to ask Pam a few questions. So, here goes Pam. Tell us a bit about yourself first, love.
Ah, good afternoon, everybody. My name's Pam, and I've known Beth here for more years than I care to remember. Actually, no, we're really good friends, and we're dog lovers to boot as well. Yeah. So, and I live in Widnes, but I've come through to have a chat with you this afternoon on the radio.
That's really good of you. So tell us a bit about yourself, Pam.
I used to be a biomedical scientist, mm-hmm. working in hospitals and the blood transfusion service. I've also been a science technician, but unfortunately I no longer work due to ill health. Mm-hmm. So I keep myself busy with singing, dog walking, of course, yes. and just generally chatting to people.
Especially on the local radio.
Especially on the local radio station.
Yeah. So I just thought, we're talking about dogs today, so I'd just like to run this by you. What is your earliest memory of having a dog as part of your life?
Well, basically, as a baby, a very young child, I remember Shandy was our family dog. My mum and dad already had her. Mm-hmm. She was a golden cocker spaniel. Mm-hmm. And I remember my mum telling me that people had said, oh, you'll have to get rid of your dog because you've got a baby coming. And my mum and dad said, no need to. No, she'll be fine. And I just remember Shandy being the most beautifully natured dog and loving her, taking her for walks. And, that's when we lived in Bury.
All right. So it was sort of Manchester sort of area.
Manchester area, yes.
So basically you've had you had Shandy. So what other dogs have you had since then?
Well, when Shandy, unfortunately, we had to be put to sleep because she'd developed problems with her eyes, we got another dog. We got a little miniature dachshund. Yes, he was called Peter.
Oh.
Short-haired, miniature dachshund. And I remember bringing him home. My brother was only very young. Mm-hmm. And I remember sitting in the back of the car and mum and dad saying, what should we call him? Mm. And I remember saying, we're going to call him Peter. And he used to nip at your toes. But yeah, yeah, he was a cool little dog.
So what do you enjoy about being a dog owner?
I think the companionship that they bring you, mm-hmm. Unconditional love. Yeah. I mean, no matter what.
Yeah, absolutely.
When I lost my mum a few years ago, my dog then, she would just, you know, kiss away the tears. Very, very, you know, and yeah. They had an empathy with you.
Yeah.
The fact that you get out and about, mm. go, it forces you to get out and take mm-hmm. exercise. Mm. And the great thing is you get to meet people. Mm. I mean, not a day goes by when I don't end up talking to somebody, which... Is that surprising, really? Me?
No, not surprising.
No.
You're so shy.
I know. Yeah. Too shy.
Yeah. Yeah. Stop singing. Not till a bit later, okay. Then, maybe. All just right. A bit of a plug later.
Okay.
Anyway.
Sorry.
Anyway, well, we're talking about dogs. I mean, I've just noticed already that you've mentioned two breeds of dogs. So that means to me, have you always had the same breed of dog?
Oh, No. After we had Peter, mm-hmm. we got Brandy. She was a mm-hmm. Dachshund, but she was a smooth-haired standard Dachshund. Then we got, I remember my brother saying to my mum and dad, when are we going to get a real dog, a proper dog? So we ended up getting Sally, or Sal Bobs. She was a Springer Spaniel, mm-hmm. and she was the last family dog that we had. Uh-huh. But the first dog that I've owned as an adult is Bailey, my beloved Bailey, who was a Border Collie.
Oh.
And got her when she was 4. She was a rescue dog.
Oh.
And had her till she was 12. And then, of course, I've now got my beautiful Ruby. Little Cocker Spaniel,
Rubes.
Working Cocker Spaniel called Ruby,
yeah.
who I just adore. She's my baby.
Oh, no. Anyway, on the note of adoring, I just thought we'd play a little song for now, and I'll come back after the break.
Okay.
And I thought we'd play Hound of Love, because it's about adoring.
Oh, yeah. That's nice.
Okay, then, let's go for that, then. Okay.
It's in the trees. It's coming.
the new sound of the city, LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Shh, the secret's out. LCR, Liverpool Community Radio. Pass it on. Join the radio. Revolution, revolution, revolution.
Dooby-dooby-doo, where are you? We got some work to do now.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5.
You're not fooling me, because I can see the way you shake and shiver.
Viva the Radio Revolution! The revolution will not be televised. It's happening online.
The new sound of the city, LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.
Hi, and we had a little blip there just to show that it is live and it's not pre-recorded. So we're just coming back to Liverpool Community Radio, and I'm talking to my friend Pam about dogs and our love of them. And I just remember talking to you, Pam, about having Bailey and then our lovely Ruby. And what made you, what did you make you decide, how did you go about buying Ruby? Because I know it was a different process from when you you got Bailey beforehand. Yeah. So how did what was the difference?
Well, yeah, well, Bailey was kind of presented to me and my son one evening because her current owner had passed away. And basically they were looking for a home for her. Mm. And I was actually working full time, so I felt that I wasn't in a position to have a dog. Mm. But they talked about having to have this healthy dog put to sleep. Mm. And I thought, no, can't do that. Mm. So I would come home each lunchtime and see to her, you know, let her out and walk her and what have you.
Yeah.
So, yeah, after Bailey passed away, obviously I was beside myself with grief and thought, no, I can't face having a dog again and going through the upset of losing her. So I looked after other people's dogs for a while, part of what they call Barking Mad scheme.
Oh, yeah. So what was that scheme then?
Absolutely brilliant. Dogs get looked after in people's homes. They match the home situation with the donor home, with the host situation. Mm-hmm. So if your dog's used to having children around, he'll go to he or she will go to a family with children around.
So what are they doing this scheme for then? What's the scheme? Is it like a dog sitting scheme for like people when they go on holiday or work?
Absolutely.
Just for holidays?
For holidays, yeah. Really. It's sort of like home from home.
Yeah.
Yeah. For people that don't wish their dogs to go into kennels, it's basically a dog goes into somebody else's home and has a holiday there with them instead while you go away.
Yeah.
And it takes away the worry. Mm. Obviously, it costs money, but like everything does. Mm-hmm. So I looked after various dogs for about 6 months. Mm-hmm. And
who are your favourites? Because I know we've had a few favourites.
Yeah.
Yeah, a few characters.
I think my favourite was a little West Highland Terrier called Spike, who was just like totally amazing. And Spikey, he used to call him. And we used to play on the beach together, sort of bounding through these puddles and what have you, and rock pools. And he was just so much fun. He was such a great little dog, real character. Loved him. And I must admit, thinking when I come, if I do get another dog, not that I will, I was thinking, yeah, I think I might get a Westie because they're a pretty cool little dog, just a nice size, nice and manageable.
Yeah.
And it was really kind of when another friend said, oh, I happen to know that there's some Cocker Spaniel puppies for sale. Didn't you say you used to have a Spaniel? I said, well, my family did, yeah. Oh, and I said, oh, where are they? Oh, they're just around the corner. Hmm. I said, well, perhaps I'll just take the phone number. Hmm. Next thing, I got the phone number. I had the phone number in my hand for, can you guess?
Seconds.
Absolutely, before I rang it. Mm-hmm. And then how long before I was around there looking at the puppies?
I'd say less than a day.
No, 5 minutes.
Gosh, that's even more keen than me.
Exactly, yeah.
Wow.
5 minutes I was around there and completely fell in love with this little girl at 2 weeks old.
Aww.
And then visited her every week until I got her when she was about 9 weeks old.
Because you got her in May, didn't you?
That's right.
I remember.
Yeah. No, it was June. It was June.
Because she was born the 4th of May.
She was born the 4th of May. Well remembered, Bethy.
No, because it's around my birthday.
And of course it is.
And May the 4th be be with you.
May the fourth be with you.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, so would you, you know, so what would you, will you do Barking Mad again, do you think? I mean, I know you've used them yourself now for when you've been away, because you went to a wonderful place. I think it's called Australia.
Yes, I did. Yeah.
And you notice something over there that we don't do over here, and it's something to do with poop.
Oh, yes, yeah. Dog poop.
Yeah.
Nearly everywhere I went, there were poo bags for mm-hmm. free mm. on lampposts or whatever for you to take as many as you wanted to make sure there was no dog mess. Yeah. And I can honestly say I was there for a month in Adelaide mm-hmm. and I saw not one incident of dog poo.
Wow.
It was amazing.
That sounds like manana over around it. Well, honest to goodness,
yeah.
I really... Yeah. So what is your view then on dog poop and things like free bags? What would you say?
Well, again, it's going to come down to the councils, isn't it? And they're going to say, well, can we afford it, blah, blah, blah. But to be honest, it's going to make the place safer, because it's going to mean children aren't going to pick up the diseases that dog poo and cat poo, of course, that mm-hmm. can generate.
Yeah.
And also make it more pleasant. Yeah. But really, poo bags don't cost that much, and you don't actually have to buy poo bags. You can use any sort of plastic bag, like from when you've been to get your vegetables, you know, you can reuse those. And other plastic bags, yes, they're making a plastic bag charge, but I think a lot of people have probably got some in storage. And now I've probably got like close to maybe about 5,000 bags stored away somewhere in my understairs cupboard. So, yeah, I'm pretty well supplied.
You are quite supplied, aren't you, love, for at least... At least a couple of years.
Absolutely.
Just a few. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But yeah, and it might encourage people. Mm. But then again, you've always got the people that pick the dog poo up, seal it in the little bag, and then fling the bag. And that's even worse, because it's never going to biodegrade.
Yeah. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
But what I thought we'd do now is I thought we'd go to another music break, and then I thought we'd actually cover a bit more about dogs and what we think about other things related to dogs. So let's go and play a bit of Elvis. I think we'll play Elvis Hound Dog, of course.
Hound Dog, of course.
Okay. See you after the break.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, girl. You're crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, girl. Crying all the time.
The world is waiting.
The revolution will not be televised. It's happening online. LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Want to join the radio revolution? Then contact LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, on info@l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. You're not fooling me, 'cause I can
see. Well, Pam, we were having an interesting discussion then about poop, and I thought we'd continue it, really. So, you think the way forward really is if we have free bags?
Yeah, and I've just been discovering that there's a scheme happening here. In Kensington and Fairfield area.
Right, give us some info.
If you're
then.
A dog owner and you live in these areas, you can get, wait for this, 100 free bags a month.
Wow.
Yeah, that's right.
That's great.
Free. Yeah. Absolutely free.
Yeah.
All you need to do is call at Medics Pharmacy or here at the Liverpool Community Radio on 53 Holt Road to register.
Yeah.
And away you go.
That's brilliant.
You will get free bags and they're biodegradable. And I'm just sampling some of them. Yeah. They look absolutely fine.
Yeah, well, thanks for that. I think we'll mention that at the end as well, to remind everyone about these free poop bags. Talking about dogs, as we have been enjoying the wonderful subject, I was thinking, recently we've brought in microchipping. It's been made law this year. But the other thing I was thinking of, what do you think we need really to make people more responsible about ownership for dogs? Now, I know we brought in dog licences in the 1930s, I think.
Something like that,
I mean, what do you think? What is your view on, you know, what should be bringing? Do you think microchipping is going to make any difference?
No.
No.
I think that licensing should be brought back, but make it a more realistic figure. I think it was like 37.5p or something stupid when it started. It didn't really change.
Yeah.
So I think they need to make it a more realistic figure, something that reflects the cost of an average dog. I mean, Ruby costs £550, but I mean, that's small fry compared to what you can pay for a pedigree dog.
Yeah.
So really, if people can afford to do that, then they can afford to sort of pay maybe £50 for the year, something like that.
Yeah.
And that might make people a little bit more accountable for what they do.
Yeah.
Yeah, microchipping's one way because it helps when dogs go missing or get out, what have you, to help them get returned to the rightful owners. But then that relies on people updating the records. And so many times you see that people haven't updated the records, so the dog can't always get returned to the rightful owner, so they've still got a problem. So it's all down to being a responsible dog owner, really.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, not everybody is.
So So what else do you think we can? Is there any other ideas, any thoughts you've had yourself? You know, being a responsible dog owner, especially recently. Is there any other things you think of that you could bring in?
Well, apart from you and I vetting everybody, you know, and pardon the pun, to see whether they are actually suitable or not, checking the home environment and taking out references on them, then I don't really know.
I was actually going to bring, that up because originally when I done a talk for today, I'm glad we brought it up. Actually, it gives me an opportunity to say that when people do take a dog home, that they've got to remember the responsibilities of having the dog is about making sure you've got poop bags, which are free from here.
Absolutely.
Also making sure you keep regular contact with the vet about any
vaccinations. Yeah.
Making sure the dog is given a proper diet and is also taken out and given stimulation, such as if it's a dog that enjoys having things thrown, toys going out into green space, and also making sure that the dog is given a comfortable bed and made to be part of the family, really. I mean, have you got any other ideas that I haven't covered there?
No, I think that's quite right. I mean, people should treat the dog as a member of the family. I mean, yes, some animals are for working purposes, in which case that's different. But even so, they still require a warm, comfortable place to sleep that's dry, whether it's in a kennel outside. That's perfectly acceptable. But things like being regularly wormed, flea treated, vaccinations, vet checks, a good diet, regular exercise, these and love and affection, I think, I mean, are really important.
Yeah.
I mean, people complain, oh, Tilly, she wrecked the kitchen, you know, she's made a real mess. Well, yeah, you've left her from 8 o'clock in the morning till 5 o'clock at night. The dog is bored. What do you expect?
So, yeah, you've got to do some other ways, haven't you, of thinking of how she can be stimulated and how she, you know, she being kept as a pet as well, so that both parties are getting a positive outcome out of it, really.
Otherwise, what's the point of having a dog?
Yeah. So would you ever take part in any behavioural classes? Have you ever had to do that for any animals that you've been with?
I went to puppy socialisation classes with Ruby because I'd never owned a puppy before.
Yeah.
So I thought that was important. But really, she was really quite easy to train. And because I'd had dogs before, I didn't find it a huge problem.
Yeah.
But I think that's important also to get the dogs used to meeting other dogs and knowing how to react and how the owner is to react as well. So, yeah, I think that's important. But if I had a dog that had behavioural issues, I would have no problem whatsoever about going to seek help and going to see somebody on a one-to-one basis or go to classes.
Yeah, you just reminded me as well is that we've actually got PDSA in different parts of Liverpool for people who have got dogs who need attention, as well as other animals who may not have the funds to support the medical attention. So, for you know, I think that's important to remember as well, is that if things are tight, as they have been for people, they are still PDSA out there for
animals.
Oh,
and they do a fantastic job.
They
operate free microchipping as well from time to time, I seem to remember, which is great.
All I remember is that we've got one in Kirkdale and we've got one in Highton. Not too sure of anywhere else at the moment. But, yeah, I think we need to plug that, really, to make sure that people don't forget the PDSA.
And then people can get help for the dog for free or for a small donation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do another music break, and I thought I'd put this classic on. It takes us back to the 1980s, and it's about a wonderful man, Lowry, the painter, and he did... did some wonderful drawings and paintings about matchstick men and matchstick cats and dogs. See you after the break.
It painted Salford smoky tops on cardboard boxes from the shop and parts of Ancoats where I used to play. I'm sure he once walked down our street cause he painted kids who had out on the feet. The clothes he wore had all seen better days. Said he just paints cats and dogs and matchstick men in boots and clogs, and Lowry said that's just the way they'll stay. And he painted matchstick men and matchstick cats and dogs. He painted kids on the corner of the street that were sparking clogs. Now he takes his brush and he waits outside
canvas and bushes were wearing thin when London started calling him to come on down and wear the old flat cap. They said, tell us all about your ways and all about them Salford days. Is it true you're just an ordinary chap? And he painted matched up men and matched up cats and dogs. He painted kids on the corner of the street that was parking clogs. Now he takes his brush and he waits outside the factory gate to paint his matched up men and matched up cats and dogs. Now Lowry's hung upon the wall beside the greatest of them all, and even the Mona Lisa takes a bow. This tired old man with hair like snow told northern folk it's time to go. The fever came and the good Lord mopped his brow, and he left his matched up men and matched up cats and dogs. He left his kids on the corner of the street.
Sound of the City, LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Want to join the radio revolution? Then contact LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, on info@l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. You're not fooling me, 'cause
I can see. Well, me old mucker Pam, we've had a lovely little time today talking about dogs, and I thought I'd throw you this bone. I thought I'd throw you this idea.
Okay.
So, woof. I just thought we'd talk about breeds of dogs, right? Uh-huh. And
not dog breeding, but breeds of dogs.
No, because that we could be there for hours talking about dog breeding, love. We're not going to go that
okay,
one.
Okay, right.
Okay, so what do you think about the favourite dog breeds at the moment, and why do you what are your thoughts on them?
Well, Staffies are still very, very popular.
Mm, yeah.
And my opinion of them has kind of changed over the years because I've come to realise that most Staffies are not aggressive. Mm-hmm. They're actually lovely, lovely dogs. Mm. It tends to be the owners that have made them aggressive. Mm-hmm. So really, it's the owners to blame. The dog is absolutely fine. Mm. A lot of them are absolutely adorable dogs. But I've noticed there's a lot of like wolf-like dogs going around, kind of Malamutes, I think they are.
Right, yeah.
They're very strong. They're very. They have these piercing eyes and a very sort of distinct look about them. And it seems to be quite fashionable to have them. But would you really want a wolf in your house, you know? They seem to need an awful lot of exercise. They're incredibly strong. I've seen people battling, nearly having their shoulders wrenched out of their, you know, their arms wrenched off. And it's like, ooh, I don't know. It's difficult.
Yeah. So what about... my vision, I've got this vision of what's the breed that they have in the handbag? What one's that one?
Is that Chihuahua?
I mean, what do you think of that? What's that about?
Well, they're kind of like a brooch, aren't they? They're kind of more like an ornament than a dog. Because they're kind of like carried around, a bit like the Germans do, the Germans.
Oh,
they carry the dogs everywhere, yeah.
No!
Oh, yeah.
I never knew that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, years ago, my husband and I used to go into Europe on the bike.
Mm.
We'd see the Germans, with the dogs in these little, like, carry bags.
Oh,
and then
they'd
have them on the motorbikes. They'd have special...
No.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I remember we had a picture of... I remember seeing a picture of Ruby, and she had her own little...
Well, yeah, we did.
Goggles. We have goggles, and didn't she have a little helmet?
She did.
I remember that. That was good. We have to get the picture out one... anyway, enough of that now.
Enough of that.
So, wow, so that's where it comes from, maybe?
The Germans are very, very fond of the dogs, so the dogs go everywhere with them.
So maybe they're a bit more
OTT
than we are.
And they have more smaller breeds, I've noticed. Mm. Having said that, we've got good friends who have an Alsatian that they used to take everywhere with them in a big cage on a trailer.
No!
Air-conditioned. Properly air-conditioned.
Wow.
For his comfort. Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
Which was lovely. Yeah.
So what you thought anyway, so what do you think about these dogs? Do you think they're all right? Do you think the temperament's suited to what our, you know, our society is?
The Malamutes?
Yeah.
Well, it's difficult to say, isn't it? Because it's not a dog I'd choose myself. A, because it's too big for me, physically too big, so I couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
Each to their own, I suppose. But like I would say, even though I've got the most beautifully natured dog, I would never leave my dog with any child unattended.
No.
Certainly would hate to think what could happen if a dog were to turn nasty, especially of that size and a young child. That's all I can say. But
yeah, because it's a hard one, that one, isn't it?
Yeah, it's personal choice, isn't it?
I think there's a naivety going on, you know, that's happened to people and
I think
taking a
sometimes
chance.
Dogs can be a fashion statement and also a status thing. And I know the Staffies are and the Rottweilers of this world, you know, the young lads go, look at me, I've got this hard-looking dog with a really thick neck and a nice studded collar around its neck, and it looks really tough, and I'm tough too, you know.
But really, it's just a mask.
I feel
sorry for the dogs.
And I feel sorry for the dogs.
But
it's personal choice. Mm. And then it's a case of who are we to say who can own what dog?
Exactly.
And then we get back to the question
debate
of
where
licensing,
who should be
allowed to have them?
Should you pass a test, you know, some sort of... You know, be set. Well, you know, get a visit.
If you want to adopt a child,
you have to go through a process.
Why not with dogs and cats?
Yeah.
To prove that you're going to be responsible.
So I've decided we're going to play a bit of another track now, but then when we come back, I'm going to read out a few contact numbers for different dog rescue places around
here. Good idea.
And then you can mention the pooper scoop thing again,
and then
we'll finish off the programme. Okay, and we're now going to play a wonderful song called Me and You and a Dog Named Boo. See you after the break. This is Liverpool Community Radio.
Power made that old car go. A woman's mind told me that never forget the day we motored stately into Big L.A. The lights of the city put settling down in my brain. Though it's only been a month or so, that old car's bugging us to go. We gotta get away and get back on.
The world is waiting. The revolution will not be televised. It's happening online. LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, www.l-c-r.co.uk.
Want to join the radio revolution? Then contact LCR, Liverpool Community Radio, on info@l-c-r.co.uk.
Hi everyone, this is Beth on Liverpool Community Radio, and I'd like to invite you to prick up your ears to listen to my show on Monday the 7th of December about dogs between 4 and 5. You're not fooling me, 'cause I can
see the way you shake and shiver. Hi, this is Liverpool Community Radio, and this is Beth, been talking with me pal Pam about dogs. But enough of dogs, we're going to talk about not howling but singing.
And Pam, cheeky.
Well, exactly, I thought it was a nice link. So I thought if you tell us about your choir a week on Wednesday, where are they appearing, please?
We're going to be in the Palm House in Sefton Park a week on Wednesday the 16th from, I think it's 7:30. Tickets can be bought through the Palm House's website. You just need to get on there and order your tickets, and there'll be a selection of festive songs and others. A really lovely evening.
And I'd like to ask you, because you've forgotten to tell me, what is the choir's name?
I sing with Hearts and Voices, but we will be singing with two of the choirs, the Royal Court Trust and also the Liverpool Hospital Choir as well. So it's three into one. So it really will be a lovely evening.
Well, thank you, Pam, for coming today. And
thank you, Beth.
Thanks for coming over. And I just thought I'd mention one or two dogs' homes, and then I think we'll howl our way out of here. And the first thing we'll do is... Exactly. Ow! Basically, you can be a dog walker for the likes of Dogs Trust and Heighton, and you can contact them on, good sound effect, on 0151 480 0660, or if you fancy helping out at the Carla Lane from Live a Bird's fame and Animal Sanctuary, you can contact them on 0151 549 0959.
Woof, woof.
Exactly. So... goodbye, and we'll see you again sometime. So don't mess around. Just make sure you pick up your pooper scoopers from Liverpool Community Radio. And here we go, and we're going to finish with Walking the Woof, or the dog, in other words. See you later. Bye.
Bye.
She can't so walk in the dark. Yes, a walking the dog. If you don't know how to do it, I'll show you how to walk the dog.
Never got back till the 4th of July. Walking the dog.